I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, what's it like when someone you love comes out as transgender?
I had lost my wife. I wasn't allowed to talk about her. I wasn't allowed to use her name. I wasn't allowed to discuss my grief.
You know, we're very good friends. But that's it. I don't have a father anymore.
Welcome everyone, good to have you here tonight. We've talked before on Insight about what it's like to be transgender. Tonight we're going to talk about what it's like to be the partner or the child or the parent of someone who comes out as transgender. Let's start with the partners first. Kerry, you've been with your husband Peter for 20 years when he told you a couple of years ago that he wanted to live as a woman.
Yeah.
Where were you when you had that conversation?
In a car. Peter was driving and Peter knew that I couldn't jump at 100 kilometres an hour.
So what did you say? How did you break the news?
At that point I was struggling psychologically pretty much, and Kerry was asking me what was wrong all the time. And I'd basically reached a point where I was at rock bottom. I had to get it out because...
And Kerry, how did you react in that car going at 100 k's?
Absolutely shocked. I had no idea what transgender. I knew transvestites, I knew homosexuals, but I didn't realise there was transgender.
Now, here's a picture of you on your wedding day. Did you have any inkling at all that Peter was transgender when you got married?
Not at all.
How long had you wanted to be a woman?
I knew I was trans when I was 19, but I didn't realise I was transgender when I was 19. I just knew I was finally born in the wrong body. And I didn't want to be a woman. I chose to stay as a male. I was going to live and die as a male. I made that decision. I didn't know the ramifications of dysphoria and how it affected me psychologically.
So you'd kept all that secret in the marriage?
Yes.
And what was it like when you found out that that had been kept secret in the marriage?
It was like a relief when I found out what was bubbling under the surface. We were having trouble in our marriage and it wasn't clear to me. I thought it was me. I did go through the anger stage. I went and then I realised that I was losing my husband. As I explained to a psychologist, the goalposts had been moved and I didn't know where I sort of
Kerry felt she'd lost control in her life. She lost all sort of sense of control in her life. The rug was pulled out from underneath her.
Tell me more about the loss of a husband. What was that like?
That was really hard because I love men and I wanted to be in a marriage with a man. And
did you think about ending the marriage?
Probably fleetingly. But then I convinced myself, well, what's most important in a marriage? And I'd found a partner that I was complete. I could be very open. I could be, I could be angry, and you'd be, you know, you'd say, yeah, calm down.
What's that like for you in terms of your relationship with Kerry?
I was the cook and the nurturer, and I dealt with the customers in our business on a business sense. So none of that has changed. I basically just carried on, but I was allowed to be the person that I really am in our relationship at long last.
What's been the biggest adjustment for you, Kerry, do you think?
Sharing the bathroom.
Oh, yeah. Every day is a bit of a challenge.
Yeah.
It's not coming completely naturally yet, and I think it will. And this sort of situation is actually helping because it's an education to me. When people look at Peter and they're so accepting of Peter, it makes me feel like, oh, that's okay, you know? You're not a freak. I'm not a freak, you know?
So, I mean, you make it sound like it's been relatively, not easy, but no, it hasn't, has it?
Definitely not been easy.
Yeah.
But I'm a pretty tough chick and, yeah, and I think it's a continual journey, but one that I'm hoping that we're doing it together and it's more honest.
Mandy, your husband of 30 years, Greg, came out as transgender 15 years ago.
That's right.
What's it been like for you?
It's been a rough journey, only for the fact that a lot of it was done secretly.
OK, so this was a process that was going on without you knowing it.
To have the gender reassignment surgery, which he's now had.
Did you have any idea your husband was transgender?
Yes. Well, Cindy used to say that basically she was transvestite and would just be happy to dress in women's clothing. But then over the years, it progressed. So I guess I sort of maybe deluded myself into believing that that's how it was going to stay, but certainly did not stay that way.
Tell me about the transition. What did it involve?
The transition involved basically was like a progression of, and we started off first of all just dressing in women's clothing. Then in 2000, the breast implants, the throat shave, the electrolysis began. Then was living 50-50. The top half was female, the bottom half was still male, and then eventually off to have the gender reassignment surgery.
And at what point in that whole process did you actually accept the idea of what was happening?
I don't think I ever accepted it. I tried, but I don't think I did.
Had the relationship been stable, steady, good before that?
It had started to deteriorate. Cindy drank. Her temper was way, way out of control. So, yeah, it had started to deteriorate.
What was that like for you?
I tried to find people to talk to and I had nobody. There was nowhere that was willing to listen to how I felt. It was all for the transgender. Nobody was on my side. Not that there's a side, but there was no one I could go to and say, this is how I feel, this is what's happening to me. I tried to reach out to the to the gender centre, but unfortunately it was all, bring Cindy in.
Now, we've spoken to Cindy. You're still married, but you've been living apart for 4 years.
Correct.
She didn't want to join us and be identified tonight, but she did talk about how hard it's been for you. What is it like for you now that you're out of that relationship?
It's still very, very hard. I still care for Cindy greatly.
So what has been the hardest thing for you?
The hardest thing for me was losing the man I loved, my home, my lifestyle. All of that was the hardest thing. And then Cindy was my confidant, the person that I told everything to. And I don't have that anymore either.
Elizabeth, you've counselled hundreds of couples in these situations. We hear a lot about what the transgender person goes through, but what happens to the partners?
Look, I think it can take a lot of time for someone to begin to really get their head around what it means to them. Just that concept of being completely disoriented and having the goalposts move from what they were expecting, that feeling of betrayal. I think one of the real differences in counselling couples where a partner is transitioning is that their processes are so extraordinarily different. There's no way of expecting them to understand the position from the other person's point of view, and I think that needs to be respected.
And what about sexual identity? I mean, what happens there? Because it's just completely thrown into disarray.
I think people can be really challenged by that, especially if they didn't see themselves in a homosexual relationship and now they find that they are, or vice versa.
How much did it mean to you, Kerry? I mean, what happened to your sexual relationship with Peter?
It hadn't really been very good for a long time because Peter was pretending to be a man and it wasn't coming from the heart. So I knew there was something sexually wasn't working in our relationship, but I'd already been prepared in that case.
And I thought it was me, and Kerry thought it was her. Then when I finally, it all came out, a lot of things were understood.
How often do partners break up and how often do they stay together, Elizabeth?
I don't know that there's any particular statistics around that. Probably more couples I've seen have separated than have stayed together.
Kerry and Peter, what's it like for you now being perceived as a lesbian couple?
I knew the L word had come up.
It's difficult for Kerry because she's a heterosexual woman. I don't know, it is difficult. We sort of come across as sisters. I think it's difficult for Kerry because she may be perceived as a lesbian and she's not.
I feel like wearing a T-shirt. I really do like men.
Danielle, your wife of 8 years, Erin, came out as transgender and became Max, here beside you.
Hi.
You started out in a lesbian relationship with Erin. You decided you wanted to stay with Max well. Why?
I loved my wife and I wasn't about to let something like the gender dictate whether I was going to be with him or not.
Here's a photo of you with Max when Max was Erin.
Yeah.
What's it like looking at that photo for you?
We weren't happy. It was a very sad... That particular time in that photo was a very sad time.
Mm. And
it
Max?
Was like battling up the whole time.
That's not me. Okay, so I'm very clear that Erin is not the same person that I am today. So I have happy memories of Erin's memories of the time that Dan and I were together. But it was a difficult time, and I think, and I wasn't aware that I was trans until quite a lot older than a lot of people.
It made sense. As soon as, you know, Max said, I think I'm genderqueer, and I went, oh my God, that's cool. Okay, all right. And does that mean you're going to wear, like, be a bit butch and, like, what's, you know, I was excited.
You're excited?
Oh, yeah, I was excited. And some things started making sense for him. I'm like, okay, cool, all right. And then about this, it was an Easter weekend. And he said, do you reckon I'm a man? And I went, yeah, I do. And that was it. That was it after that. It happened really quickly, over a few months. It was only a few months later he was on testosterone. There was only it all happened really quickly.
And what was that like for you, having it happen that quickly?
It was chaotic. It was traumatic.
In what way?
Well, like Maddie, I had lost my wife. I wasn't allowed to talk about her. I wasn't allowed to use her name. I wasn't allowed to discuss my grief. Max was so... and rightly so concentrating on himself, very inward, trying to deal with everything that was going on and the changes, and he was also excited.
Dan vacillated between being incredibly supportive and incredibly angry.
Oh, yeah. And I've got a voice that's like a weapon of mass destruction.
She's not kidding.
You know, and I...
So what sort of things would you do? When you were angry, what were you like?
Anything to punish him, possible, you know. There's so many times I want to stab you in the eye with a fork, you know. But never did, of course. But, you know, we'd be fighting a lot because I wasn't allowed to express my grief.
So you felt you didn't have a voice and that was why
absolutely.
You were angry?
Dan didn't have a voice.
I didn't have a voice. And we lived in regional Queensland. And so I was away from my family. You know, I'd be screaming, like, I hate your guts to, oh, my God, I'm not allowed to talk about my wife. Why is it not about me as well? Mm. I had no support. We were in regional Queensland. There was no support for me. Mm. We lost our friends. I lost Max's family, in particular his siblings. I never spoke to again once Max came out. And, you know, I'd been part of that family.
And you lost them too, Max.
Yeah, my relationships with my family changed fundamentally at that point.
Mm. But it's interesting that was such a big thing for you, Danielle.
Absolutely, because they were my family. I didn't have a very close tie to my siblings and I was treated by Max's parents as one of the girls. you know, and I love them. I love them all, and I lost them all.
Did you think about how, what sort of reaction you might get from Danielle before you told her?
No. And I know that that sounds incredibly selfish, but I think to put a context around that, Erin operated as half a person for most of her life. And when it was that I finally figured out what it was for me, that, you know, that I knew who I was, that I knew, then I had to grab that because it was all I had.
What happened to sexual attraction?
I'm gay. I'm a gay man.
Yeah. So where does that leave you, Danielle?
Well...
divorced.
Sexually, the sex was much better after he came out as a man.
So your sexual relationship?
Our sexual relationship.
Before I came out, yeah.
Before he came out as gay.
Yeah, there's a couple of coming outs there.
There's a couple of coming
outs. Yeah, I'm keeping track. I think I'm doing at the moment.
So,
yep.
You know, he identified as genderqueer and then it was like he was a man. And then so the sex was much more frequent and really good and I couldn't keep up and... because that's what happens when you go on testosterone and they have this new adolescence and that's all they think about. But also, at the same time, I saw Max going on social apps for sexual encounters with men. But after a while, I really thought, no, this is not okay. I really think Max is gay. He was open about it and I saw him interact with the gay men in the community group up where we were from, and it was magic. You know, he lit up. He was witty and charming. And
but where does that leave?
So.
But where does angry. That leave you?
That leaves me really betrayed and isolated and bereft, because I would have stayed till the end with him, but he was gay, and I sort of said, Max, you're gay. Oh no, but I love you. I said, yeah, I'm leaving. And it was the darkest time of my life. There were suicide attempts. There was... I was diagnosed with PTSD. I was isolated. There was no support for me as the partner or as now the ex-partner.
So where are you up to now?
Now, 2 years later, I don't want to stab him in the eye
with
a fork. We're really good friends. It took a lot of time. We had to be separate.
We had, you know, Dan's happily repartnered.
Yeah.
You know...
I have a beautiful partner who, and we have a 3-year-old.
Lauren, you stayed with your partner. Now, you fell in love with Toby next to you 2 years ago.
Yes.
When you were both living as women.
Yes.
As well. Toby's been taking testosterone and transitioning from female to male in the past 7 months. What's that been like for you, and what's it like listening to that story?
It's really intense listening to everyone's stories, actually, because I look at us and go, wow, we're really boring. Like, I met Toby when he was Megan, and we worked together at a cafe, and... Hello. Oh, God.
There you are.
And, you know, the first time... we got on really well at work, and the first time we actually hung out outside of work, he said to me, look, I actually think I'm transgender. And I was like, oh my God, that's so exciting. Tell me more. I need to know all of the things about it.
What happens to sexual attraction in that situation? And how did you wrap your head around Toby's new identity?
For me, it just wasn't an issue. I love Toby for who he is, not the gender that he is.
Okay, so you make it sound like there's been no adjustment, but there's, I mean, you must have had to change something around the way that you relate to one another. No?
Well, it wasn't so... because what people don't realise is I told her I was transgender before anything happened between us. Mm. We were just friends. So she had to make that decision. Mm. Am I going to date a trans man? And I had already said to her, but I don't think I'll do anything about it. It's a bit too intense, yada, yada. And she turned around and went, no, get in the car, we're going to Adelaide. And didn't give me a choice. And it's the best thing that ever happened to me. Because...
It probably does make a big difference that it was part of the deal from the very beginning.
The get-go, she knew what she was getting and I knew what I was getting from her. There was none of that exploring and intenseness that you guys had in having to learn.
It's a different
later.
Time.
Lauren, what about your identity as a lesbian, part of a lesbian couple? How did you feel about that changing?
It was actually, I say it sounds so stupid, but it was fascinating for me. I love watching how the brain works and just watching myself kind of evolve and watching me and Toby evolve into a heterosexual couple, because that's how we get seen now.
And so you have a baby?
Yes, we do. We have a 5-month-old.
And you had the baby?
Yes.
And
oh, yeah. you think it's hard?
Goes without saying.
Pregnant and transgender, that would be full on. I recommend anyone who can do it.
No, I was not suggesting that's a good idea. But the baby has your genetic material, though.
Yeah, that's actually a bit of a funny story. My brother's my best friend, and I said to him, "Hey, Nick, would it be weird if I borrowed your stuff to have a baby with Lauren?" And he said, "Oh, just let me think about it, all right?" He rang me like 2 days later and he goes, "I don't know really why I had a thought about it, but I don't want to go near Lauren, but yeah, we can do it." And I was like, "Cool." Thanks, Nick.
And how old's the baby?
5 months.
Why do you think your relationship's surviving so well?
I think because we have a very open line of communication, because you have to.
To the nittiest, grittiest detail, like, I've got rules about terminology to do with my sexual body parts. Mm-hmm. She's not allowed to touch my breasts ever because I haven't had surgery and they're still there. And she's never got it wrong. Or if she has got it wrong straight away, it's like, "Ooh, sorry." Like, and it's just, and we laugh. That's the other thing too. We laugh about everything.
The day that she said, "I want to live the rest of my life as a woman," she exploded an enormous bomb, and the carnage from that will exist forever.
Right, which one are you going to get? That one? Which one's going to do this one here?
I wish you like your shape.
Oh, just clean them up nicely. Okay.
You want to make it all even? Yeah?
Make it all even, yeah. So you guys want to get some sushi after this?
Yeah.
Yeah, do you want to make it or do you want to buy it?
Buy it.
You want to buy it? I thought we were going to make it.
No.
No.
Make it.
You want to make it?
I like your sushi.
You like my sushi better? All right, sit down. Here you go.
Thanks, Daddy.
You're welcome, sweetie. The girls, this is all they know. They don't know any different now. If I ever have a day where I go back to being masculine, then they actually get uncomfortable.
What about when Dad comes to school and that's...
I don't mind, but Mum doesn't like it.
I just say at school, Daddy beats the boys because I don't want anyone to tease me or anyone.
Has anyone teased you yet?
Nope.
No? It's okay then.
Because Dad's a girl, they think Dad's my mum. They'll ask different questions like, why is your dad a girl? And yeah, I just say it's none of your business. Just leave me alone.
Do you like to go shopping with me and buy stuff together?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fragile piece of art.
Sorry, I should.
Here, go and open
it up. Can I pull it out?
Yeah, show it to me. Okay. Very careful. How's that? Do you like that?
Yeah.
Stop.
Don't do that. What do you think? The tag. Look good.
It's pretty.
Ready? Get your photo of you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'll get a photo of you too, sweetie.
Can I wear it?
Yeah, you can wear it. Here. How's that? Yeah? Oh, okay, here.
Michelle, you started taking female hormones 2 years ago.
Almost,
right?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah? And you were Daniel then. Now, those girls, your daughters, are 6 and 9.
Correct.
How have you explained it to them? What have you said to them?
Oh, I really... It just developed. It wasn't anything I'd sat down, had a conversation. We just had a bit of fun. Daddy just likes feeling pretty. I just really kept it simple language.
How do you think they've coped over those 2 years?
They've done really well, actually. One of the things I am really passionate about with transition is going really slow. Not really slow, but letting people go along with you and transition with you.
Okay. They talked about school and about the idea of being teased at school. How do you feel about that, and how do you manage that?
That's actually a very sore point. My ex has actually banned me from going to school since coming out. Unfortunately, recently, I went to a school fete, and the compromise was I had to detransition for a day and go as a bloke. And it was the only way I could walk around the schoolyard.
And how did the girls deal with that?
They weren't happy.
What's their relationship like? What's your relationship like with their mum?
Touch and go. 1 minute we're great mates, the next minute I've ruined her life and she's got to deal with it all. And
do you have sympathy for that?
I do. And I've tried helping, finding her some support like others had found, but I found even some of the support areas I went to on Facebook were actually gatekept by transgender people as well and wouldn't let me come in to actually help find the right places to help her.
Your daughters had quite a while with you as a male dad.
Yeah, they did.
Didn't they?
I said to them, are you happy with daddy being this way, or do you prefer daddy being a boy before, like daddy was before? They said, no, I prefer you this way, daddy. And I said, why? Well, you were grumpier. I didn't see you as much, and I couldn't, you know, I can hug you so much more now than what I could.
And they call you dad?
Yeah, still daddy, yeah. Mm. Yeah, I'm very adamant on that one. My ex really tried to push to have me come up with a whole other name, and I said, no, I said, I earned that. I stood there when they were born. I'm still their dad, and I'll be their dad till the day I die.
Okay, Elizabeth, does the age of a child make a difference to how the child reacts to the parent being transgender?
I think the age makes a big difference. If the child is young, very young, like pre-puberty, and the adults around them are supportive and confident and coping comfortably with the transition, then the children will just take it in their stride, just as young kids do with lots of change. But if the child's post-pubertal, then there's a whole lot more around needing to be seen as cool, and they tend to separate somewhat from their parents anyway, so there's a lot more fear about what that's going to mean for their status as an individual with their peers.
Josh, you are rolling your eyes as you are listening to this. Your father came out as transgender 20 years ago when you were 17.
Mm-hmm. So I was in my final year of high school, right at the beginning of final year of high school, and the first conversation was about the separation. My parents were separating, and I don't remember asking too many questions about it at that point. But about 3 months later, I was brought back together, and at that point I was told why they had separated, and that was because my father had thought for his entire life that he should have been a woman.
What did that do to you as a 17-year-old boy?
I think what it did is the thing that it continues to do right through to now, and that is a kind of search of understanding of what it is to be a man. When that person, your masculine figure, is lost to you at the most pertinent age, and suddenly it's three women in front of you, what are you supposed to do? And that's the search I continue to have. What is it to be a man? Now, I don't mean in the sense of, you know, questioning my own gender. I did that, but I don't mean it in that way. I mean it just in that sense of, men, what do you do? I don't know how to see myself.
And is that because you feel a sense of loss of your father at a critical age?
Massive. Huge, huge loss. You know, I have a 5-year-old, and that was a devastating moment for me when I found out that I was having a son. Because I thought to myself, I don't know what to do.
Were you close to your father?
I think so. And I say I think so because I actually don't. The more time goes on, the harder it is to remember what our relationship was.
Karen, you're listening to all of this. What's it like for you listening to all of this?
It's hard. We've talked through a lot of things and a lot of issues, and my timing wasn't exactly perfect. But when you hit rock bottom, the choice was either my family got Karen or they got nobody. That's how low it was.
You were suicidal.
I tried to commit suicide. I was lucky I didn't. And in answer to what Josh just said, we were very close. I took him everywhere, all the sports, whatever he wanted. I was there with him. It's hard when I hear him say, I don't remember. But there's some things I don't want him to remember either.
But I think the thing is that the person that sits here today is entirely different to the person that I grew up with. They are not the same people.
This is very different to what people have said earlier tonight.
Correct.
Your experience.
Yeah.
So what's it like when you look at this photo of you with your dad?
I think the thing about it is that I look at it and I can obviously pick up the tenderness that there was between us. But I look at him and I don't know.
What's it like for you looking at that photo?
I can't relate to it. When I was that person, I didn't like to look in the mirror. I can look in the mirror today and say I love you so much easier. I can do it all the time. My ex and I are still friends. But it was a lie. There's no other way to put it. I fought it for a long time. I knew most of my life.
Josh, with Karen sitting beside you, do you still think of Karen as in any way your father?
No.
Not at all?
No.
So what do you think of her as?
To me, this is a friend of mine. You know, we're very good friends. But that's it. I don't have a father anymore.
How do you feel, though, when he says that he doesn't feel like it? Do you feel like his father?
I can't deny I was his father. I'm proud of it.
But past tense?
Past tense. It is past tense.
See, this is interesting too, because it's different to the way Michelle feels.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I still do Father's Day and it's Daddy and...
You know, we are who we are. This thing happened to us and I think that I'm just on this journey of trying to work out how I live the rest of my life with it. As I've said to Karen time and time again, the day that she said, I want to live the rest of my life as a woman, she exploded an enormous bomb. And the carnage from that will exist forever. It will go on. It won't stop. The next generation, you know, because the thing is that my son, suddenly it becomes his thing as well. Do you know? He has to carry it on and think about it and how is he going to deal with it?
And it's 20 years ago that it started. Yeah. So it's still very much a live issue for you in terms of something you struggle with.
Yeah. Yeah. But
do you think you've accepted it?
It's a great question because I think that there are moments where I would say absolutely, fundamentally yes, and then I would have moments where I would say to you, I waver with a question about it. But the thing is that I do know...
Don't tell me about the times you waver, OK?
the thing I do know is that I want this person around. I don't not want them around. I want them around. It's just about how to negotiate that relationship sometimes.
And you're still working that out.
Yeah. Hmm.
What sort of support did you have during this?
None.
How do you two relate to one another now? How do you talk to one another?
Yeah. Well, I think that shifted and changed ultimately when we sat down opposite, we went and locked ourselves in a house down the coast for 3 days and picked apart our life.
How long ago?
Only two years ago. And there was no question that was off limits. We could ask anything of each other. And we did that over 3 days. And I think that fundamentally changed the relationship, and then the next shift and the bigger shift really was just over 12 months ago. I had a massive mental health breakdown, and Karen was the first person I turned to, aside from my wife. And Karen called me every day for 5 months to say, are you okay? Right, good.
I still see Josh totally as my son. But I see myself as his parent, not his father. That's the way I handle it, and that's what I'm comfortable with.
Have you met another child in this situation before?
No.
Ever?
No. And so
I'd like to introduce you to Greg.
Hi, Greg. That was one of the things, you know, that for 20 years I felt isolated, you know, and now I've got someone sitting beside me.
Yeah. So, Greg, your dad, Tina, over here on the end, came out as transgender when you were 25, so a bit older than Josh.
Yep.
We've got a photo here that's... you're in the middle, Tina, is on the right, and your brother's on the left. How did you react at first when you were told?
I definitely wasn't expecting it. So I thought we might be losing the house or losing the business or...
It was going to be big.
The main thing I thought was that Dad was sick, so I thought... Yeah. We'd had cancer in the family before, and so I thought maybe... this was the talk that Dad was really unwell.
And what was it like when you found out what it was about, that Dad was wanting to be a woman?
Probably the very first thought was that, OK, it's not the big, bad things that I thought it could be. Mm. First of all, I needed to ask or clarify what transgender was.
But then, once it sank in?
It was a bit of a bombshell in the effect it was going to have on everything, and we definitely didn't... everything that I thought was going to go off with this bomb probably wasn't everything that did go off. Like, I think my sisters put it as ripples, like, you know, something happens and then other people react. And because, as we've heard today, everyone reacts differently. So everything just sort of shifts a bit. But it hasn't made me sort of question who I am. It's more just about the fact that my dad's more who she wants to be. And I've realised that's more important than gender or, you know, saying, hey, I still have a male... dad and a female mum, like all the books and movies, but I think it's just more important that Dad's happier now, and that's more important.
Mm-hmm. Ali, you were the only child who was still living at home when this happened, when this was announced. How did it affect you? How did you react?
I actually laughed when she first told me. I just went, oh. And then I think it was kind of that thing of same as Greg. It was relief, shock, definite shock, but mostly relief. And I mean, we were raised to be pretty progressive anyway. We were, you know, we talked about the news around the dinner table, and we were always encouraged to be informed and self-aware and self-reflective. And I think that really helped having that foundation as a kid. To kind of say that my morals say that I would accept anyone who's going to come out. So it doesn't really matter that it's my dad. It changes it in terms of it might affect me more, but the principle is still the same.
Has your relationship with your dad changed? I noticed you call Tina dad, yes, both of you?
Yeah.
In any way at all?
It's just, you know, Dad does different things now. And but, yeah, not that much, actually, but except that now I feel it's more honest. And
yeah, I think we understand her better, but in terms of who she is, I mean, you're talking about, you know, Karen having completely become a different person, and I really don't feel like Dad is. I mean... I really still recognised her, and she's still her.
I think I had certain things that weren't so big, but maybe to do with my male identity. So we used to watch the footy together, and our family are like half swans and half hawks. And there was a point, at least in the transition, where Tina, I think you were identifying less with that football thing, and I was like, oh, I actually kind of really like that thing.
Tina, do you still feel like their dad?
I never stopped feeling like their dad. I mean, it was interesting. It just shows how everyone's transition is different. Mm.
Yeah. Your mother has dementia. How has she reacted?
Oh, wow. That's a great story. My mum had, about 2 years ago, she had early stage dementia. I just sort of told her and she listened. And when I was finished, she said, well, what do you know? She said, I've got a beautiful new daughter. And I started to cry, and then Mum said, she said, come here, love. And she gave me a big hug, and I cried on her shoulder, and she's just beautiful. Anyway, I knew she'd forget, and she did. So each time I see her every few weeks,
I'd remind her. And every time, the reaction was exactly the same. She'd say, well, she said, you're beautiful. She said, you know, are you happy, love? I go, yep. She'd say, good.
Ali, is there any loss for you in all this?
It's a strange thing to miss. I miss Dad's smell. Dad always wore woolen jumpers and they just had this very particular smell. And I found her jumper in the cupboard and I smelled it and it seriously knocked me to the floor. It was such a nostalgic smell. And now she smells like flowers and perfume and makeup and cream. And I think that's one of the
things. That's a very childhood thing, though, that sense of smell. And
Dad and I have always been really close, really close. And lots of hugging. I mean, there's photos of us, you know, just like lying on the couch under dunas watching TV. And that physical closeness was always really important. And I think that's something that I had to get used to, because when she came out and she'd had, you know, reassignment surgery and then you know, breast implants, it was just kind of like, I'm hugging something that feels much squishier than it used to. And that was it kind of freaked me out, to be honest, to begin with. It was like, this is a very different kind of feeling and, you know, a very physical way to understand someone who's transitioned. And I've gotten used to that now. We hug all the time and it's fine.
It's not going to be what I imagined for my child. I'm not going to have the same as what my friends have. But, you know, I accept it.
Sharon, tell me about this photo.
This was my child when he was, I'd say about 13 or 14, before he came out as lesbian at the age of 14, and then subsequently at the age of 17, told me he was transgender.
When did you first become really aware of this?
About the male business? In 2013, only 2 years ago, when he was 17 years old.
And how did you react when you were told?
Not well. I was in denial. I did not react well at all when he told... He didn't actually tell me. What he did was he gave me a documentary to watch, which was about a trans, you know, trans man who had a family, etc. And I said to a friend of mine in these words, oh, my God, I have a horrible feeling that Navor wants to become a man.
How did you get from that position of being shocked and reacting badly to the position you're at now? I mean, what has gone on in that two years?
I think it's education, really, being educated about what I didn't understand.
I should mention why Navo, who is now male, isn't here tonight, because he's just had surgery to remove his breasts.
Correct.
I'm really excited to get rid of this. It's been limiting my breath and movement for enough time now.
You know what? I think that's actually what I'm focusing on. I'm focusing on the fact... I'm trying not to think about the surgical part of it. I'm trying to focus on the fact that you've been wearing a binder for 2.5 years. Not only does it constrict you in your breathing, but also the fact that it's a constant reminder.
I'm so excited to just feel the material of my shirt on my skin.
On your skin, yeah.
You know,
yeah,
and to wear that out and to feel the wind on my chest, you know, like it's something, it's just minor, but like it's a big deal.
I can imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's quite amazing that the hospital where you are having this surgery is the same hospital that you were born in.
Yeah, especially because I've never been to hospital aside from my birth. So it's like my second visit to hospital is at the same place.
Yeah.
Just 19 years
like
later.
Like being reborn.
I guess. Yeah.
It is.
A lot of people have said that. I don't really feel like that.
So how would you describe it then? If it's not a rebirth, how would you correlate that being at the
evolution.
Same hospital? I think it's very...
I think an evolution.
Okay.
A part revisiting,
of your evolving.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe a revisiting rather than a rebirth. It's like I'm going back to like make amends on something that, you know... I'd love to be able to say to the doctor who announced I was a girl, but actually, no. And you shouldn't have said that.
Yeah. I've had the best of both worlds.
Yeah, there you go. You had a daughter and a son, I suppose.
Exactly.
I just wonder what it's like as a mother to have your daughter go in to have breasts removed as a male.
I was really focusing on the result as opposed to thinking about that loss. Mm. When we went to the endocrinologist, when he was being prescribed with testosterone, the doctor said to me, "You seem to be taking this remarkably well." And I said, "Well, what choice do I have?" And he said, "Do you know how many people I see, transgender people who come here without the support of their parents?" And I said, "Well, this is my child and I love him unconditionally."
What about the name change?
That was hard. That was very hard for me. In fact, when Nivo chose his name, that was when I was in denial and I had no input there. Whereas the name that my ex-husband and I chose, Liat, is Hebrew and it means "you're mine." And we struggled to get her. I mean, sorry, there you go, you see. Struggled to get him. It was IVF. So I knew I was only going to have one child. I had three stepchildren and there was going to be four in the family. And I wanted a daughter. Life throws us curveballs.
Mm-hmm. Has it changed your expectations as a parent?
Yes, very much so. I mean, it's not going to be what I imagined for my child, you know, growing up, getting married, having children, blah, 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 blah. Although he says that these things still will come, but it's not going to be in the traditional sense that I've been brought up in. And I'm just going to have to get used to that change as well. I'm not going to have the same as what my friends have. But, you know, I accept it.
Janet, you're Toby's mum. Yeah. You've also experienced your only daughter becoming a son in the past year. What's it been like for you?
A little bit different in the fact that Toby's path had got quite... he was heading down a path of destruction at the time when Toby was Meg back then, to the point that it was separating us as a family as well. We had got to a point where the little contact that we had was volatile or not abusive in a physical but sometimes in a verbal and whatever sense or emotional sense. So when Toby actually finally decided, because it was about a four-year process or three-year process of him going backwards and forwards between being gay, being female, to going to the male that he is now. In that time, having also met Lauren, who has been our saviour, we now have a relationship like... I wasn't going to have this relationship with my daughter. So I don't feel like I've actually lost anything. I have got my child back and that's my important thing. I've basically got the perfect son. So, you know, I can't feel sad about that. That's a good thing.
Kerry, what about the sense of loss that I've talked to other people about tonight?
About the grieving, yes. We all go through a form of grieving, but I explained it to a psychologist that I had at the time that with a death, it's final and then you sort of wane off in happy memories. But in this case, you're living with that partner that's...
The corpse is still walking around the house.
Yeah, in high heels.
That's not a pretty picture either. But a lot of nodding over that. Yeah. Yep.
It's like they're dead, but not dead. Yeah. You know, the person that you knew isn't there, but there's no gravestone. Mm. There's no service, like a funeral service, where you can honour them, or there's none of that. And seeing Max was
she
a
was
constant
a cool
reminder.
Woman. Like, she was a really cool woman. And, you know, I wouldn't change the decision to transition, but I didn't know that I would lose so much of that person.
Yeah.
Where did all the parents and the children and the partners in this room of transgender people find support?
I didn't get support anywhere. Nowhere at all, no matter how much or where I ever reached out to, dead end.
Yeah. Like, I think it's very hard. Like, I've been to a couple of counsellors and you have to explain what transgender is to them. And that takes up most of your time.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Would anything have made it easier, Josh?
Probably not, to be honest.
And that's okay. Because ultimately I am a better person for having gone through this experience. And I wouldn't take that back for a second at all.
When I look at myself when I've had such an easy journey, like I went out and I went, right, okay, there's no group in Mount Gambier where we're from. Let's create that. Let's make it open to friends and family so that they can come and they can get support and they can talk about it. Because you don't have a space to do that.
Ali, would anything have made it easier for you, do you think?
It helped having three siblings, and we're all born within 5 years of each other. And so I think I drew on my family for support. I did talk to counsellors, but
I think we were our own support for the most part. So at least we knew we had that, and then we got what we could outside. But I was amazed and shocked at the time that there was not more support from, like, you know, medical services or government services. So as with many other communities, it's looking after itself and it's doing the best it can, but that's nowhere near acceptable levels. Like, it's just trying to survive in a lot of ways.
We're going to have to leave it there. Thank you all so much for joining us tonight. I'm so glad you all got a chance to talk to one another and share your stories. And that is all we have time for here. But let's keep talking on Twitter and on Facebook. Twins times two. Next week, we begin a two-part special. What twins can teach us about ourselves, our health, our behaviour, even our destiny. We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everybody.